You're listening to the audio production of Guys Are Waffles, Girls Are Spaghetti by Chad Eastham with Bill and Pam Farrell, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Bill Farrell and Pam Farrell.
A note from Chad.
Who are you people anyway?
I, Chad, heard a great analogy in a lecture once that mentioned waffles and spaghetti as girls and guys. When I looked it up, sure enough, there was a collection of books for adults on the subject by Bill and Pam Farrell. I found the analogy worked great with students, and eventually the Farrells and I got in touch. We have talked for the last few years about taking this concept and applying it to you, the teenager. And with Bill and Pam's extensive knowledge on relationships and counseling, and my background in research, writing, and speaking with teens, we finally got this thing cranked out. And we like it. We also noticed that my girl editor, Mackenzie, and I expressed our thoughts and opinions in a very waffle and spaghetti kind of way throughout the book. So we left some comments in just for your entertainment. We hope you like these pages more than we do. It is your book, after all.
Why Alex Hates Me.
I received my first piece of hate mail this past year. To be honest, I was really excited. I mean, how often do people go out of their way to sit down and say how much they disapprove of you as a human? I am honored when teens write me to tell their stories, ask their questions, pass on their jokes, or share some of the random craziness in their lives. But I usually get positive things written to me. I had never received mail that just said, "Hey dude, I don't even like your existence. I want you to know that I don't like you and I think you're dumb and ugly, so take that." Until this one. It was from a guy named Alex. He had a strong opinion about the first book I wrote. "Hey man, I just wanted to write you to tell you some stuff. I think it's cool that apparently you go around talking to kids like us and helping people out and stuff, but I also think that you're full of crap, man. And I just have to say that I mean, you just can't go around saying things like guys are this way and girls are that way, like you know what we are and why we do things we do. You can't just say that people are a certain way when you don't know anything about them and stuff. I just think that's stupid. And you don't know everything, so don't act like it. It's a total scam, man. So no offense or anything, but I think you are wrong and shouldn't say the things you say. So yeah, I guess that's it. Bye." Jackpot. That was a pretty decent hate letter. I mean, he got pretty bold, but he still tried to be polite by saying hello and goodbye in his own special way. He used some good, strong verbs, got his emotions out, and ended the letter kind of awkward, which happens to be the perfect way for a teenage guy to end a letter. Then I thought about how much I would have sounded like that in high school. This letter wasn't copied word for word, by the way, but it's pretty close. I had to change the misspelled words so it sounded like English. There were 32 to be exact. I wrote Alex back and said thank you. I also told him that when people disagree with me, I try to take it as an opportunity to learn something. And then I asked a question that had been lingering in my mind since I read his letter. "Hey Alex, I want to ask you a question. Please don't take offense. I am just really, really curious about something. Did you actually read the book? Or did you pick it up in passing and read the cover or hear someone else mention something about it? I just would like to know if you don't mind." So Alex was honest with me. He had only read the cover. He told me what I had suspected from the start. His girlfriend, who had read the book, called Alex out on some stuff that he was doing. His girlfriend also took a generalized view of guys and probably said, incorrectly, that all guys act that way all the time, or something to that extent. Some of it is hard to tell based on Alex's ability to write and spell real not good-like. Alex is now my friend. I told him what I actually meant in my book. He took it well, and he now understands that not every single thing I say about guys and girls and their behavior can fully describe the unique qualities we all have. He also took me up on my offer to talk instead of just staying mad and confused. Turns out, hate mail can be kind of cool. When I was in high school, I hated to be categorized, and yet I did all kinds of things to blend in. You could have categorized me as a heterosexual, suburban-dwelling, movie-quoting, girl-watching teenage guy. I used to hear people talk about guys and girls and say guys are this way and girls are that way. I dismissed it, even though a lot of these statements describe things about me. I rejected the notion that people can be understood that simply, or that we can put people into cookie-cutter boxes of behavior and thinking. I still reject that notion. But I also think in the midst of your uniqueness, you have general features that are similar to other people, depending on your gender, age, background, and genetics. The simplest feature is a basic fact. If you are a girl, you have two X chromosomes. If you are a guy, you have an X and a Y chromosome. I had, and still have, a lot of typical general male traits and behaviors. But I also have a lot of traits that are uniquely me. Or as I say sarcastically sometimes, you are unique and special, just like everyone else. And while I'm joking, I'm also not. When I talk about what it means to be a guy or a girl, it is only in an attempt to understand some of our feelings, thoughts, development, and behavior. What I share will never fully explain you or me. You will not fit neatly and cleanly into any category, but your gender is a physical thing. Your body, your brain, your emotions, and the way you approach problems, romance, conversations, and friendships are all affected by whether you are a guy or a girl. I am not telling you something new when I say guys and girls are different. The goal is to look at how we are different and how we are the same. By first doing this, we can learn to understand each other so that something else can happen. We can learn to treat each other well. We can learn to empathize with one another. We can also learn some things about God. Trust me, when you try to do these things, every one of your relationships will be better. Whether it's with the person next to you in math class, your parents, friends, your latest crush, or the person you end up marrying one day. The Bible says something about this that is simple and profound.
Wisdom is supreme, therefore get wisdom. Though it costs all you have, get understanding. Proverbs 4:7.
The more we understand each other, the better off we all are. Thanks for being curious. I wish you all the best on your journey. Chad.
A note from Bill and Pam.
Food always helps.
It's funny how ideas happen.
I had been a pastor for a few years, specializing in helping husbands and wives with their relationships. I had read the research about how men and women approach life differently, but knew that it was way too technical for most people. So I was looking for a word picture that average people could relate to. A man called me one day and said, "Bill, can I bring my wife in? I think she's broken." When they sat down at my office, he looked at her and said, "Go ahead." At that, she began talking and talking and talking. He looked at me, he looked at her, then looked back at me and said, "She does this all the time. I think something's wrong." In a spontaneous moment, I thought, guys respond to food, so maybe I can help him with a food picture. So I said to him, "Think about your wife's conversation like a plate of spaghetti. As soon as she has touched every noodle, she will finish talking." In response, he said, "Okay," leaned into the conversation, and really listened. Maybe for the first time. It took a little over an hour, but remarkably, she finished talking. He frantically turned to me and asked, "What do I do now?" "Nothing," I said. "Just thank her for sharing and say nothing."
She leaned back in her chair with a content look on her face and confided, "That was incredible. I can't believe how important I feel to my husband right now. So what's a guy's side of this?"
Well, I quickly glanced at my watch and told him, "We're out of time today, but we're going to meet in a couple of weeks. I'll let you know then." After they left, I told God, I have 2 weeks to come up with something. Please show me what the guy's side looks like. A few days later, my sons were making toaster waffles for breakfast. As the waffle popped up, I thought, that just might work. I explained to the couple that men are like waffles. Our brains have lots of little compartments. We put one thing in each box and then deal with one box at a time. I told the wife that she had to stay on whatever subject her husband brought up, and she could not change subjects at all. It was hard for her, but she responded to my promptings to stay on subject, and they resolved a problem that had been bugging him for a while. I left that meeting knowing that this was something that would help a lot of people. My wife, Pam, and I are so thankful for Chad and his ability to make this information interesting and understandable to teens. We'll drop in from time to time when there are things we want to share too.
Chad, take it away and run with it.
Chapter 1.
You say, "Ooh," I say, "Awesome."
"What's that smell? Oh, it's me." When I was growing up, I spent a lot of my summers at the beach visiting my dad. I loved the sun, seeing my dad, stepmom, and grandparents, and catching up on some surfing. You could say, in fact, that I love surfing. And in my hometown, surfing is a pretty big deal. I'm not as talented at it as I am passionate about it, but I try. In fact, one summer I spent so much time surfing that I kind of lost track of a few other things that I should have been doing. One of those things was bathing. Every morning I woke up early, grabbed my board, went to the beach all day, and made my way back home in time for dinner. And then one day, before we actually went somewhere nice to eat, my dad came into my room. He always had a cool, calm manner about him, and he kind of looked at me and said, "You should probably take a shower." He said it so plainly that I believed him. He obviously knew something I didn't. Apparently, everyone did. It had been 28 days since my last shower.
Right in thought from Mackenzie. Just a note from your editor. Seriously, this is gross.
Chad, thank you. I know because I felt a little proud about it. I also figured I swam in the ocean every day, and that's like nature's bath, right? Most people disagree. I like the sand and wax and grit in my hair. I like peeling feet and sunburn. I also liked that I could actually get away with not showering for a month. As I walked to the bathroom, I remember saying to myself with a little grin on my face, I love being a guy.
Why, it's great to be a guy.
A trip anywhere, for any amount of time, requires only one bag.
We can kill our own food without any feelings of guilt for the bunny.
A guy can dismiss almost any problem, annoyance, or confusing situation with the phrase, whatever, followed by walking away, a negative quality according to females everywhere.
We get extra credit for even the slightest act of thoughtfulness.
We can pee standing up anywhere on earth.
Car mechanics tell us the truth.
We can sit quietly or play a game with a friend for hours without ever thinking, he must be mad at me.
If someone forgets to tell us something important, he can still be our friend.
If someone else shows up at a party in the same exact outfit we're wearing, we just found our new BFF.
None of our buds ever trap us with statements like, so, notice anything different?
No one expects us to know the names of more than five colors.
We don't have to shave anywhere below the neck.
A few loud burps and other noises are generally expected and tolerated by most people.
All phone conversations can be done in under 30 seconds.
Our bathroom lines are 97.8% shorter. Weekends are for girls.
Annie's weekend turned out pretty awesome, thanks to her natural female flair for fun and creativity. Friday afternoon, she finished her report on female inventors of the past century, which included some really cool inventions like the fire escape, life raft, rotary engine, circular saw, Kevlar, and the chocolate chip cookie. Later, all of her friends came over for the first segment in a weekend of endless girl-only fun and relaxation. She and her sister cooked a theme meal for her girls' night, which featured only Moroccan food. Then they piled in the basement that night with an amazing amount of pillows that only girls can conjure up, watched movies, talked until late in the night, and finally fell asleep with stomach pains from so much laughing. The next morning, Annie and her friends ate a great breakfast and headed out to a nature party in their favorite city park, where they met up with a few more girlfriends. They planted trees and made a very eclectic design out of pine cones, leaves, and trimmings, which they left on display as a tribute to the event. Then the girls headed to the spa where they had pedicures and laughed about how guys never enjoy getting pampered like this. Energized, they went to the Cracked Pot, a pottery painting boutique, where they painted pottery to represent their own unique personalities. After dinner and bowling, they headed back to Annie's house for a girls' dance and karaoke party that went on for hours. Later, Annie and two of her friends sat laughing on the couch. In a quick but insightful moment, her friend Nicole just looked at her and said, "Isn't it great to be girls?"
One time, I, Chad, was not a girl.
Note from Mackenzie. This is a little lame and weird.
Chad, I know, but when I got up this morning, I was a guy. Still, I have my limits, Mac. In fact, I've always not been a girl, but I know some, and there are definitely some benefits to being a girl.
Why, it's great to be a girl.
You can cry without pretending there's something under your contact.
Speeding ticket? What's that?
You actually get extra points for watching sports.
If you're a lousy athlete, you don't necessarily question your worth as a human being.
You don't feel the need to deny going to the tanning bed.
You possibly could live your whole life without having to endure a group shower.
You'll never have to decide where to hide your nose hair clippers.
If the person you're dating is much better at something than you are, it doesn't kill your ego.
Talking and people watching can be a great time.
Your friend won't think you're weird when you ask if there's spinach in your teeth.
If you're under 6 feet tall, you don't have to lie about it.
You'll never regret piercing your ears.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.